Darren, thanks for coming on the Disruptive Entrepreneur podcast.
You're very welcome, thank you.
I'm really intrigued. How does one become known as the human lie detector?
I sometimes wonder that myself, to be honest with you, Rob. It was a PR man's idea. I met a guy.
I think it's good, by the way.
It's very good. Yeah. Well, it goes back to 2009, 10, something like that.
Yeah.
I was at a networking event and I met this guy that used to be a journalist for the Daily Mirror.
Yeah.
A guy called Steve McComish, and he was setting his own PR company up. And as I was sat there drinking my wine and drumstick, he said, we should have a meeting. I've got a few ideas. So a few weeks later, went in, had a chat with him, because I was looking at kind of getting my profile up there a bit more, moving more into media. Because until that time, obviously, I was still in the police, but I was still sort of doing other things as well. And he said, I've got a great idea. He says, can you tell when people are kind of lying? And I was like, yeah, I'm sort of trained in that stuff. And he went, human lie detector. And at the time, Cheryl Cole had just been cheated on by Ashley Cole, and the general election was looming. So he fired a press release out, and it just went ballistic.
Right.
And that was the start of it.
Yeah. Wow. And you built up all of this knowledge of understanding people's tells and if they're lying in the police. I guess your long career in the police?
Well, when I was a kid, there used to be a show on Donkeys years ago, which some people may or may not remember, called Cracker with Robbie Coltrane.
Yes, I do. I'm just about old enough for that.
And I used to love that show. I was really inspired by it. So I did psychology at uni.
Right.
So I wanted to be crack. I wanted to be like this you know, sort of psychologist that went around cracking crimes and stuff.
Yeah.
And like most things in life, you know, the reality of it was nothing like the fiction.
Mm.
So once I graduated and spent a little bit of time in the prison service, absolutely hated it because it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. And so I was looking around and I had a few friends that are in the police. So I basically went to the police force in Nottinghamshire.
Yeah.
Eventually transferred to Derbyshire. I was in about 17, 18 years in total.
And what did you do in the force?
I was a response officer, so going to 999 calls.
Right.
And in the course of doing your job, you're naturally speaking to people on a daily basis, on interview, that are suspected of offences.
Right.
So I think even though somebody, maybe they haven't got a degree in psychology, when you're talking to people in that context a lot of the time, you know, you do tend to build up, the ability to build rapport quite quickly, but also you begin to get a kind of a copper's nose, they tend to call it, where you'll get kind of a lot of experience in terms of being able to decipher where people are being open and honest with you and where people are trying to sort of shift liability. Because the consequences of obviously being discovered of being involved are obviously prison or you know, that's worst case scenario. So people did tend to give off a lot of signals. But essentially my training comes from NLP, Neuro Linguistic Programming, thing called micro expression training tool, and psychology and experience.
Okay, really. So I can see this interview going down two roads, and let's have some fun here. Some sort of the more fun lying, spotting stuff, Darren Brown, NLP, all that, and then the using it for sales and marketing.
Absolutely.
As an ethical way.
Yes.
For example, clients or leads
lie
to you all the time. Oh, I'll pay you tomorrow. That kind of thing.
Yeah.
Or, you know, yeah, I'm really interested in this. I'll get back to you.
Yeah.
And did your police training help you spot all those tells for people in business?
Well, basically, the signs that people give off in deception are all linked, like, to emotion and then also to liability. So when I get interviewed, I mean, I've done a lot of interviews now over the years. And, you know, journalists often say, well, I'll think of three things and I'll make one a lie. And I'll say, look, it's not going to work because I'm not Darren Brown. It's not a trick. I'm not a magician.
Mm.
So basically, there's a thing called detection apprehension, which basically means what's that person's perceived perception of the consequences if they're discovered in the lie.
Right.
Now, you know, if I steal your Muller Lite out of the fridge, you know, if I say, look, Rob, I didn't take your yogurt, you know, the consequences are going to be minimal.
Yeah.
You know, I may lose a little bit of trust with you, but principally, I'm not going to go to prison for that. So emotionally, you know, there's not much impact on me as an individual.
Right, so there's less tells because there's a weak, not as strong an emotion.
So effectively, I'm not really too bothered if I get discovered stealing a yogurt.
Yeah.
Whereas if you then say, well, there's money missing in the office, you know, I've got to ask everybody, you know, Darren, be honest. And if I did do it, there's going to be a certain leakage, is what we call it.
Can you give us a few examples of it?
Yeah, so for example, there's a bit of a myth that people looking in certain directions, that's a myth. But what it does do, it gives you a great understanding of you know, how people are processing things. So
you mean if they're trying to make up a story and imagine it?
Yeah.
Or if they can recall it?
Yeah, so no one thing will give a clue to deception. There's about 8 or 9 different variables. So some you know, everyone's got a baseline. So, you know, on a well-known chat show, when they do a lie detector test, they'll ask somebody maybe 10 or 20 control questions, so things that are true.
So you're observing their standard,
yeah,
normal.
So where they look with their eyes for information,
yeah,
where blood goes, ears, nose, lips,
yeah,
fight or flight syndrome, how people are animated or not. And also, there's a thing called voice risk analysis. So insurance companies use it now. So when people are putting in a fraudulent claim, the computer software can detect changes in voice pitch.
Wow.
So, even the human ear is imperceptible sometimes, but essentially I'm looking for breaks in 8 or 9 patterns of baseline behaviour.
And can you list those patterns there?
Yeah, so it'll be breaking eye contact, it will be changes in voice, it will be shifting posture. Some people overcompensate eye contact because they say that liars can't look you in the eye.
Right.
So if you and I look at each other right now, normal eye contact is 3 to 5 seconds.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3. So for now, at 5 seconds, slightly uncomfortable, so you look away. Whereas, look, Rob, I didn't take your yogurt, you know, and it's this overcompensation that it becomes a red flag.
Yeah.
So it's generally...
So you're looking for inconsistencies in behaviour.
Yeah.
But whereas the Darren Brownie NLP, this word, you think, so, oh, that's the inconsistency, that means X, it's compared to someone's personality.
Yeah, and even so, even these techniques, even a polygraph is maybe 70 to 85% accurate, because that's why it's not evidential.
Yeah.
So there are people that can give off false positives. Right. As a police officer, when I was behind a vehicle, sometimes you could, you know, some people were nervous, you know, so you do a traffic stop.
But they might be nervous anyway.
And they're nervous. Yeah. So their baseline, you know, I do now, you know, I've been in the job.
Yeah.
Get a police car behind you, you know.
Yeah.
So some people's baselines are quite nervous anyway. Mm. So you have to compensate for that. So it's a dangerous thing to suddenly say, well, I think you've been deceptive.
Yeah.
You know, there's got to be overwhelming changes in the baselines, such as voice, eyes, posture. Yeah.
What about skin colour? Because I know sometimes I can go very red.
Yes.
So do some people's skin, or like you said, ears?
Yeah, so it's all to do with the fight or flight syndrome. So, you know, they say that when we're stressed, you know, blood's pumped to the legs to either run away or to the arms to fight. It's kind of like
that's interesting.
Goes back to, you know, caveman times.
Yeah.
And what tends to happen is the visible parts of the body are lips, ears and nose.
Right.
And some people will go very pale, whereas some people will go very red, in line with that process. And some people also get what we call turkey neck, so they'll also go very red around here.
Oh, okay.
So again, we can't say they're lying, but there's been a change in emotion.
Yeah.
And then the other key thing that we look for is a thing called micro-expressions. The guy in the States called Paul Ekman, who was behind the show called Lie to Me, which people may or may not be aware of, with Tim Roth.
Yes, that's great.
I used to love that show.
Yeah, I mean, I love that show. I sometimes wonder how much of it is for TV.
Yeah.
Is there a lot of truth behind that?
Absolutely, yeah. So this guy, Paul Ekman, I mean, I think he's in like his mid-late 70s now, based in San Francisco. And he went to like Papua New Guinea for like 10 years and studied people in the outback who'd never been in Western civilization. And what he discovered was that no matter where you are in the world, no matter what culture you come from, there may be cultural differences. So for example, I think it's Greece, you know, if they sort of say yes, they sort of shake their head and say yes. So with the micro expressions, he discovered there's only 7 basic laws of human expression.
Go on then, let's have that.
So we can be happy, we can be sad, we can show fear, we can be surprised, show anger, and we can show contempt and disgust.
Right.
And even people that have been congenitally blind since birth, they'll still flash the same expressions, even though they've never had any visual clues.
Yeah, because they're doing that in the TV show, aren't they? They're watching little bits of footage.
Yeah.
And then they see an emotion just spill out.
Exactly.
And that's true to life, is it?
That's real, yeah. So these are basically like 1/5 of a second.
Yes.
So if you've got 2 people, one gets promoted over the other, you know, so let's say, for example, you just got some really good news. And I go, oh, I'm so pleased for you, Rob, that's fantastic. I've just flashed disgust at you.
Yeah, I saw that face.
And I slowed it down to make it visible.
Oh, right.
So
I thought I was getting good at this.
So essentially, you think, well, why would his underlying emotion be disgust? So that's another thing, is my emotion's not consistent with what I'm telling you.
Yeah.
So that becomes a red flag.
Right.
So no one thing is a guide to deceit.
Yeah.
And the other interesting question is, okay, well, we've established a breaking pattern. So why would that be? Why are they trying to hoodwink me?
Yeah. Because, for example, in a sales situation where maybe, you know, in a one-to-one position where they're lying, it's because they maybe, you know, they'd be embarrassed to turn you down.
Absolutely.
Or they don't want any conflict, or they like you and don't want to hurt your feelings. And they're not necessarily really unethical standpoints.
Not at all.
They'll rather lie than feel uncomfortable.
And I think we've all been in a position, because I've done a lot of sales as well, and obviously I have to sell myself every day for my business. And sometimes people will give you false objections, won't they?
Yeah.
You know, they'll say, well, the other guy's cheaper than you. And sometimes I'll get a kind of a glimpse of something. So it's about establishing that deep rapport with that person. Because sometimes people don't want to be honest with you. And they're not trying to hurt you. Sometimes, you know, I mean, statistically, we can be lied to up to 200 times a day.
Wow.
And the majority of those are white lies. It's to avoid conflict and hurting your feelings.
Yeah.
You know, so the example is obviously a partner or some, you know, maybe one of your employees says, oh, do you like my new hair or my new top? And yeah, that's great.
How do I look in this?
You know,
when your fiance or wife says that.
I think majority of guys.
Okay.
I think what I found is women are more inclined to say, I don't like it. More when guys are more inclined to lie and say, you know, I think you look great.
Right.
That's what, you know, the evidence seems to sort of suggest.
Yeah. Okay, so I've had something that's popped in my head. I want to go there and then come back.
Yeah.
So I did a little test. I love to read, study.
Absolutely.
And I read a book called Radical Honesty a while back. And I feel truth is important.
Mm.
And maybe in the last 10 years, I've tried to live by more truths.
Sure.
Of course, I'm a human being. I'm not going to beat myself up if something spills out. And I did this little test in an interview. We were interviewing someone and he was really nervous.
Right.
Really nervous. And I'm a bit more forgiving of nervous people now because you don't really see the real them in the interview. And he was losing us and we were losing him and it was a bit obvious. And I cut it a little bit short and I said, look, I just want to be honest with you. We're not going to hire you. I think you've probably had too many jobs in your CV and I don't think this is right. Really appreciate you coming. Gave him a smile. And he went back and he put the stinkingest complaint in to the recruitment agent. And he was like, Robbie's an evil. Well, I'm going to go and tell everyone how awful that company is. And I thought, I've just done something really good here.
Yeah, but honest,
And it's not just... I thought I was doing the right thing for him,
yes.
But obviously I wasn't. And also, it gave us a bit of a bad reputation with our recruitment agent. And so Mark was looking at me when I was doing this interview, going, what? and afterwards, he said, you just should have shook his hand and blah. What are your thoughts on that?
See,
radical honesty versus white lies.
See, I would love to have do like a social experiment where maybe a personal group of people. I mean, it goes back to that film with Jim Carrey, Yes Man, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Where you ever see that film?
Yeah.
Where he just tells, and he gets himself into so much shtick.
Yeah, yeah.
So I would be interested to see the results of an individual that literally lives that for 24 hours, because I think it would cause so much upset.
Yeah. So are you saying that sometimes lies, white lies, they are a better thing to do or they serve a better purpose?
See, I'm more inclined to be honest. If someone says, because I expect the truth. If I said, Rob, what do you think about this? And you said, to be honest, Darren, this is good, this is not so good, I think you should maybe look at this, then I think that would say yeah, because I'm that sort of person that thrives on feedback.
Mm.
But for a lot of people, they don't. So I think, A, it's an individual thing for that person, because some people can't deal with it.
Yeah.
So I think it just errs on the side of what you think is appropriate in that situation.
And probably having a good understanding of the person.
Yeah.
Like if I'd have known that person would have reacted like that, I could have just said, thanks for coming to the interview, here's the next stage.
Yeah. But I think we're all, you know, even as kids, you know, we're kind of told at Christmas, just say you love that jumper, wear it at Christmas, wear it at dinner.
Yeah.
You know, you sit there with this horrible, hideous jumper or something. So we're kind of brought up to kind of be deceptive, but maybe at 12 or 13, we kind of grow out of it. But some do. I mean, I'm sure you have in business. There's a reasonable amount of people that are pathologically inclined in lying. That they'll just lie for no reason, even if there's nothing to gain from it.
Yeah.
They just have adopted that kind of behaviour. Mm. And that's a bit interesting.
So are you saying then that there isn't necessarily a one-size-fits-all strategy for whether we are all truth?
Yeah.
And it's based on the person and how you think serves their best interests?
I think for me, it comes down to what's that person's intention for being deceptive. So there's different degrees on a scale. If it's to kind of, you know, hoodwink that person or con that person, then obviously it's not a good thing. But I think sometimes if it's to avoid conflict or to avoid hurting that person, maybe sometimes it's appropriate.
Yeah.
You know, so it is, it's a massive grey area.
Yeah.
And like you say, Yeah, it's a perfect example of one size fits all. It doesn't really.
No. And also, if you know you've just been lied to and you call someone out on it,
yeah,
that can really break rapport. You could build an enemy for life, couldn't you?
Well, because, you could.
Because they're protecting something by lying, and then you call them out on it.
Yeah. Yeah, I think people around me now, they kind of tend not to, not because I'm this big ogre or anything, but they just tend to be honest with me if I say, yeah, what do you think about this?
They go, well, if you're known as the human lie detector, then...
but you know, it's I'm human. I mean, if, yeah, you know, wouldn't you know these skills? If I said something to you, you'd go, Darren, I saw something there. Yeah. So I've got the same physiology and neurology as you and as everybody else. So I'm not perfect. I'm not unique. I'm not special. Yeah. I've just followed a path and got to a level where I'm pretty competent at it, like most people in business.
Right.
So it's not something that anybody else with an interest can't learn.
Sure. Something I feel like I've learned over the years, and of course I'm never perfect, always learning more, is if you ever call someone a liar, for me that is 100% of the time a bad thing to do.
Mm.
What do you think about that?
That's a really good question. I think, again, it's context specific. It depends how you do it as well. If you say, I don't think you've been completely honest with me, you know, I've done that with plenty of people in business, you know, and some people go on the defensive.
Mm. Or could you say, oh, someone else told me X, or I did a bit of research and I thought X. Yeah. Am I wrong here?
Yeah. So, for example, if you know someone's done wrong, one way of doing this, it's called a silver bullet. You could say, oh, somebody asked me about the situation that they're going through at the moment. What do you think should happen to that person if they get caught?
Right.
So then you're eliciting what they think.
You're testing their moral judgment.
Their moral compass.
Ah.
So there's lots of little kind of mind games that you can run on people.
Yeah.
I've got a friend.
Is this one of those? I've got a friend.
No, I have got a friend that's whose husband was working away and coming back. He was in the forces and was coming back maybe every couple of months. And when I met him, sometimes in life you meet people, don't you, and you either gel with them quite straight away or you think there's something not quite right about you. And I said, he asked me about my work, and I said, yeah, I said, I had a thing the other day, actually. I said, I said to a guy, be honest with me, have you been cheated on me while you've been away? Now, he wasn't sure if I was asking him directly, but I framed it as if a third person. But in that hesitation, I saw about 7 or 8 leakage singles.
Wow.
And a year later, it's come out that he has been cheating galore. Right. So my dilemma was, should I tell her what I think? So I didn't, you know, because I thought it's a big thing to say to somebody.
Mm.
But now that she's...
And actually, if you haven't got proof...
And again, that is the key thing, is that none of this stuff replaces the hard truth.
Yeah.
I do a lot of work with HR people, train HR people in spotting people on interview.
Mm. Remind us to come back to that, because I'd like to talk
about
that.
Well, I won't go off at a tangent then, but essentially I always say that this is by no means a replacement for an HR process.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, there to support and enhance what people already do.
Mm. So sometimes when you watch the police shows, they're going into the house, they're interviewing the perpetrator, they come out and they go, oh, I know they're lying. Is it like that?
No. And I'll be honest with you, the police are the most retroactive people for these sorts of techniques. Right. I actually repitched a lot of police forces and they won't touch it, because you're trained in a process called the peace model. And that is about 50 years old, but that's essentially where you have a plan of an interview and you just follow you have a list of topics that you want to discuss. So it might be, where were you at the time? You know, do you know this person? And you never ask a question unless you've already got the answer. So, you know, and you're not allowed to kind of play mind games, because that's classed as oppressive.
Uh-huh.
And believe it or not, silence, a lot of people hate silence.
Yes.
Whereas if I sat there quietly for about 15 seconds, the solicitor would very often say, officer, you've been oppressive.
Interesting.
Yeah, so the police are very, very in the box.
Yeah, I suppose there's a lot of peripheral things about getting sued and...
Yeah,
yeah. All that kind of
but
thing.
All the, you know, especially in the States, and I spent quite a lot of time in the States, went out with the sort of LAPD on a bit of a ride-along and see how they do things, and that was amazing. But they're trained in all this stuff, like the TSA at the airports, they're trained in micro-expressions, and all this sort of stuff, and other countries around the world are.
Yeah.
So okay. It's interesting.
Have you ever sat... when you're in the police and you just thought, that is an outrageous lie? Got to give us some examples.
Yeah, I mean, there was one in fact, it's interesting, a guy comes to mind, he was a prolific burglar, and like the evidence was overwhelming. in terms of people seeing him CCTV, but he would just sit there and say, no, I was never there. You know, just completely front it out. Mm. And I thought, as an individual, psychologically, like, I sat what I called second position him, so I sat in his head, reversed the process. And I thought, how could you sit there with all this evidence and someone go, no, it wasn't me, you're mistaken. Mm. But what do you do? You know, he did get charged and sort of convicted. But
so it was his strategy then to almost show with overconfidence.
Yeah. And some people do. I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm not perfect. I mean, I wasn't using these skills officially in my role as a cop, but they did help me. Mm. You know, so if I saw certain things, I mean, a senior officer once said, Darren, check everything, believe nothing.
Yeah. Trust but verify. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, so sometimes people would seem very, very plausible, and you think, well, I can't believe this guy's involved in this. But then you'd kind of check out their story, and it was rubbish. Mm. So you know, anyone could be hoodwinked, no matter how good they are.
Yeah. So that's in the police. What about in business or personal life? Any like outrageous lies? Or you do a lot for the media, don't you? You comment on a lot of the big celebrities.
Yeah. So I mean, Donald Trump's paying my bills at the moment. So I write sort of freelance for the Daily Express, and I've sort of wrote about 20 articles in the last month. Again, politicians are great because they do go off to lots
they're
of tells.
They're a great subject for you.
They're a great subject, yeah. The one person that I've been asked to assess in politics who gives nothing away is Tony Blair.
Oh, wow.
He is like a lizard on a rock. Like I assessed the Iraq inquiry a few years ago, and he sits like this because he was obviously used to be a barrister, but his posture was like this, and he doesn't move. You can't get a baseline on him. He's just so stoic.
Right.
Whereas somebody like, say, Cameron, not so much to do with deception, but to do with anxiety. Mm. He would lick his lips and he would step back a little bit from the podium, which psychologically is saying, I've got no confidence in what I've just told you. Mm-hmm. So, you know, certain politicians have their tells.
Yeah. So is there anything recently in the media which you saw as an outrageous lie?
Not politically. It's more to do with, I mean, the one thing I've worked on is like Donald Trump. I mean, the media are obsessed with Donald Trump, for example. Yeah. And his handshake, you know, like he'll yank people towards you. Mm. And that's a big test to do with personal space. So if you're not going to allow yourself to be pulled in, then he knows you're going to be a little bit difficult to deal with.
Right.
But I've not seen anybody sort of overtly, blatantly lying.
Yeah.
Because they are trained in all this stuff. But
of course.
But even though they are trained in it, they can still give off lots of tells. But
yeah.
Generally, it's more to do with anxiety or maybe not believing with whole conviction what they've just said.
Right. What about in the celebrity world? I mean, you referenced some celebrities who cheat on celebrities. Is there anything you've ever spotted there?
I mean, one thing I worked on was like the Tom Hiddleston stuff and Taylor Swift. I mean, I knew that was rubbish from the outset because they just weren't consistent, you know, when I was looking at the footage and stuff. It was totally inconsistent with, I mean, I looked at Tom Hiddleston and her with when they were in the relationships, and a lot of their tells and gestures weren't consistent because people, by and large, don't change, really. You know, their behaviours and gestures will always be pretty much consistent. Mm. So I knew that was kind of rubbish from the outset, just a bit of a PR stunt.
Yeah. Okay. So let's now delve into the world of business and entrepreneurship.
Sure.
Why don't we start in sales? Because I know you consult and do sales training.
Yeah.
And you do it for HR departments as well.
Absolutely.
So let's go in sales first.
Sure.
So where do we start? I'm going to be led by you this time. Where should we start a discussion with the human lie detector in the world of sales?
Well, again, you know, there's no sort of compensation in terms of having rapport with that person. So, you know, a salesperson should still do what they've always done if it works for them. But what I do is I teach in terms of building an enhanced rapport. So people may be aware of matching a mirror and posture. You know, so if you and I are talking and then at some point I'll kind of shift a little bit about my posture or something. The theory is if you're in rapport with me as a prospect, then you will shift your posture, you know, in line with me.
Yep.
And that denotes that you're kind of, I'm leading you sort of unconsciously. And the reason for that is that, you know, you're being very receptive to what I'm saying. And I'm sure we're all aware of how people can be quite visually referenced or more auditory or more touchy-feely.
Yeah.
So I teach a lot of salespeople to spot the signs and signals of what their prospect has a predominance in. So for example, if they're very visual in the way that they buy things and I'm very auditory, you know, I will say, does that sound like a good idea to you, Rob? And you may you may say overtly yes, it may seem okay, but because you're processing things visually, you know, a more appropriate thing would be to say, how does that look to you, Rob?
Yeah. So you're looking for the visual cues in the language.
So you're looking to match your language to that the way that person's sort of processing what you're saying.
Yeah.
Likewise, if someone's quite kinesthetic, quite touchy-feely, you know, if I'm selling you this cup, if I don't let you play with that cup, it's going to drive you crazy.
Yeah.
So in order to get to close them, you're more inclined to get a deal if you let them play with the product, if you recognise that that person's more of a kinesthetic person.
Right. Okay. And you referenced, I think you said advanced rapport, did you say? You used it?
Yeah. So that's, again, looking at in terms of what we call anchoring. Yeah. Are you aware of anything called anchoring at all?
Well, I might be, but let's see.
Okay. So we can look at maybe a picture, or we can smell something, or we can hear a piece of music, and it will trigger a memory.
Yes.
That's like an unconscious response that we've learnt.
Yes, I hear the song Jeremy by Pearl Jam, I basically start to cry because I played it when my first girlfriend, who I ever had, dumped me. And that was like, I obviously still haven't got over that, as you can see.
So you know, that is a perfect example that, as far as the mind's concerned, because my background's sort of hypnosis as well, as far as the mind's concerned, the mind and body are linked. So by hearing that, you know, a lot of people, you know, although you may be over that now, for some people, anchors that have been established in childhood can still be very, very powerful now.
Yes.
So what you do is, when you say to somebody, I would say to you, think about a time in the past you made a really good decision, Rob. And in that moment where you're considering what you're saying, what you're going to say back to me, if you're quite a visual person, you will look away. And in psychology, we call it a transderivational search. And you're kind of playing a little picture. Now, I wouldn't respond back to you until you come back to me.
Yes.
But then when I come to pre-close you, I will gesture in the area that you were seeing your previous movie.
Right.
And what's happening unconsciously is that I'm connecting the feelings of making a good decision that you had before with me. So by gesturing in that spatial area, it's called spatial anchoring.
Right. Yeah.
So by gesturing in that area, I'm consciously, you're not aware, but unconsciously, your brain will associate those feelings with everything. So it's a way of building rapport to a much deeper level and more advanced level.
Sure.
So it's quite. People say, "Yeah, but that's unethical." Well, it's not, because you know everything you're telling your prospect is true.
Yeah.
You know, they are getting all the features and benefits and everything that you're telling them, but obviously you're using a toolkit to make them feel more at ease with you.
Yeah, that's a good point about the ethics, actually, because
it is important.
What is manipulation and what is elegant influence? I suppose for me, it would come back to, do I believe in what I'm selling?
It's about having passion in terms of what you do, because, you know, when I first started off, I was called a charlatan. I've been called all sorts of, you know, when I've wrote articles that this man should be in jail. And I'm a very ethical person because I come from that background. Mm. So I think it's like anything, you know, you could hit me on the nose with your phone, even though that's not its intended use. So any skill or thing could be used, you know, for the wrong reason.
Yeah.
So I think the ethics and the integrity are really important with this stuff, because you can, you know, do things with the conversational hypnosis and the psychology of this, and you can do harm.
Yeah.
You know, so it's important that people do use it with integrity.
Okay. So when you're teaching sales teams, give us some of the top things that either work the best or they love the most.
Okay. I think it's to do with the anchoring, really, because everyone can identify with the fact that they can think about something in the past, you know, that evokes a certain feeling. So, you know, even if you can get a handle on what's that person's passionate about, you know, so it may be a place, you know. And I know we're all told, you know, when we get trained in sales, look at the pictures around them, and if there's a picture in Hawaii, talk about that. And yeah, that works to a degree, but by drawing out and eliciting even more information about what makes them tick. Also, you could say, how do you know, I'm really curious, how do you know you've done a good job? So if I said to you, how do you know you've done a good job, Rob, what would you say?
When there's really good reviews about it, when someone tells me I've done a good job.
Yeah. So I'm the same. So we would, what we call externally referenced. So in terms of motivation, it's important to establish how that person motivates themselves into action. So for some people, they'd say, well, I just know. So problems arise sometimes in sales forces where you've got an internally referenced manager, sales manager, and then externally referenced salesman.
Right.
Because the salesman would say, do you know what? He never tells me I do well.
Yes.
But for the sales manager, he assumes knows. Or she assumes that everyone's the same as them. Mm. So by being aware of the people that are around you and what makes them tick's really important. So again, you know, just by asking a simple question, you can elicit what makes that person tick.
Yeah.
And so, they love that.
Yeah. Okay. Something I've always found probably the most valuable is finding out somebody's values.
Yeah.
So John DeMartini was probably the person who taught me the most about values. Yeah, he's been on the podcast. He's a good friend and a mentor of mine. And essentially, what's most important to you in your life will naturally bring out, that question will naturally bring out someone's values.
Definitely.
So do you use any kind of values-based work?
Yeah, I mean, essentially, the quickest way to establish someone's core value, you know, is saying to somebody, so, you know, what's important to you about this? Yeah. And they may say, well, it gives me freedom. Mm. So when you have freedom, what does freedom give you? And then they'll give you another word. And then you say, so ultimately, having freedom and maybe that's flexibility, what do those things give you? And it may be happiness.
Yeah.
So if you ask somebody that question three times, the third thing will generally be their core value in terms of what drives them and makes them passionate about what they do.
And then you build the pitch around that or the outcome?
Essentially, yeah. So you build the outcome around that core value.
Yeah.
So everything comes back to that. So, you know, for me, it's not manipulation. It's not being underhanded. It's
I could throw that back the other way around and say, if you care enough about someone to find out what their values are and match your product or service with their values, you actually care about them.
Yeah, because you're going, yes, you're going to get the sale, but it's about more than that. It's about having that relationship with that person and then knowing that, you know, when you come around and when you're going to offer them something, that, you know, they're doing it from a point of view that they're not just wanting the signature on the line, you know, that you do care about their business and that you do, you know, you do want them to succeed, you know, and you're there to do good for both of you, not just you.
Our common interests, you know, things we're both very interested in, is that good for rapport and sales? Does that make a difference?
Absolutely. I mean, anything that builds similarity. I mean, they say that birds of a feather flock together. Yeah. And that's true. You know, if you can establish a genuine interest, or you've got a genuine interest in certain topics, and even learn from each other, you know, because we all learn every single day. No one can ever be all knowledgeable. Yeah. And I often say when I do public speaking is, I'll get a piece of paper and I'll rip the corner and I'll say, that's what I know. And that's what I don't know, because we can never know everything.
Sure.
It's brilliant.
And I suppose, because some people have said to me in the past, well, you know, what if we just don't have any rapport and we're really different? But you can still show a real interest in what someone's interested in.
Yeah.
And, you know, show a desire to learn more about it.
No, definitely.
You know, you like martial arts. I'm rubbish at martial arts.
Yeah.
I'd love to know more, though.
Yeah. I mean, the thing about this is some people do it very... When people mess up is, for example, if you say you love martial arts... And I say, I love martial arts, but I know nothing about it. And I end up looking silly because I'm trying to convince you that I do. And you clearly know I don't.
Right.
It's much better to do what you've just did and say, look, I don't know anything about
it. Tell me about it.
But I'd love to learn. You know, I'd love to get it. So that's coming from a point of view of having a lot more integrity than some salespeople I've seen in the past that just are basically just overly, you know, like if you've got a picture with the kid, or I've got kids, or I've got that car, and you haven't. It becomes, just, I don't know, it just seems really false.
Yeah.
Another interesting one is people often say to me, you know, if you've got a prospect that's really sort of dismissive, or, you know, somebody might say, oh, that he never buys anything. You know, some people have this old myth about if I fold my arms, sometimes it can be a signal of disinterest, but I would encourage people to match them. So if you match that other person, because it might just be a comfortable posture.
Yeah.
And at some point in the conversation, just begin to slowly sort of go to this position. They'll find a lot of the time, 80, 90% of the time, that the person will begin to match you. So you can lead even a cold client, you know, out of that place where they are and feel very comfortable with you.
Yeah.
So even if someone's like that, even if it doesn't feel comfortable for you, just try it, you know, because you're still you. You're still retaining your values and beliefs. But it's about leading that person to a common ground where they can be more receptive.
And how do you work sales techniques into a way that you don't seem like a machine? Because about 10 years ago, I did a load of personal development courses. I mean, I've done...
Yeah, sure.
I've done about £1.2 million worth of courses and mentoring and, you know, have consultants in because I really believe in it. But, you know, when the sort of NLP courses were big in 05, 06, 07, I did a lot.
Yeah.
And you got all these people that were really digital about it and
absolutely.
Almost like machines.
Yeah.
And it was all about hypnosis. And you're just like, what are you doing to me? You know, how do you do it naturally?
I can identify with what you're saying, because like it's almost they want to go out and just like fix everybody. Yeah. I think, do you know what I mean? Yeah. And everyone was like trying to put me in a trance and all that, and I'm like, look, I know what you're doing.
Yeah.
And
because body mirroring and matching, I mean, you know, and leading can be so overt and obvious, can't it?
It can, and obviously, you know, you're aware of all this as well. So I think it's just taking what you've learned and integrating it, and be yourself, I think, is the thing is. Don't go in somewhere and try to be the big shot or try to be something you're not. It's just, this is what I've got, this is who I am. It may work for you, it may not work for you. Mm. But I think, certainly in a sales context, if you genuinely get on with that person, you know, maybe they say, look, Darren, you're too expensive, and maybe I can't budge, and you may not get the sale on that occasion.
Yeah.
But I think business, the problem sometimes in business is everybody wants it now.
Yeah.
You know, that person may ring you back in a year and say, do you know what, just come and see me again because I've had a fallout with my existing company.
Mm.
So I think there needs to be some sort of longevity in this process.
Yeah.
But for me, I often find people that I work with, they want it all now, and it doesn't work like that.
Right. Yeah. Is it true, the saying that people buy from people they like?
Absolutely, because I think, first and foremost, you can be a lot cheaper than the person I'm currently buying from, and you can be, you know, the product can be even doubly fantastic. But, you know, I mean, I've gone to restaurants, and I don't mind paying X amount if this, I mean, service is important to me, you know, because we'll work hard for our money. But one thing I won't tolerate is poor service.
Mm.
You know, so sometimes I'll ask for the manager and people will go, oh, sorry, is everything all right? And I'll say, yeah, I just want to say thank you because it was great. Because I think a lot of people don't say thank you enough.
Mm.
I kind of got off piece a little bit on that.
That's all right. Well, let's go back on piece. People buy from people they like. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I do. I think first and foremost, it's about having that genuine rapport with somebody. And all these techniques that I've spoke about, they're just something in your toolkit. I think if you're the sort of person that loves people and loves to talk, you know, I think that's going to come over.
Yeah.
And people will gel with you, and they'll realise at some point in that process that you are a genuine person.
Mm.
You know, you're passionate about what you do, and you've just been open and honest. You're not there to hoodwink them.
Sure. How do you know when to go for the sale and then when to back off?
That's a really good question. I think
I'm going to need to take some notes here.
Well, I get asked that a lot. I think, for me, it's almost like an intuitive thing, you know. So we spoke about being external or internal, but we move in and out of those two places depending on the situation. And for me, when I was sort of, or when I do sales now, is it seems to be a natural place that occurs. For me, it's a sort of a feeling that I think, well, okay, so before we kind of get everything sort of put into place, you know, is there anything else that you're concerned about? Anything else that I need to tell you?
Yeah.
You know. So it's almost leading into the close rather than just kind of getting a contract out, the dreaded contract and the pen. And because that's the point at which, you know, most people get the kick, don't they? You know, most people sort of raise objections at that point.
Mm.
But I think if you've been building rapport all the way through the conversation and you allude to the close, you know, rather than making it a milestone, it's almost like, before we kind of get things in place then, Rob, is there anything else that you need to ask me?
So they call this test coat closing or pre-closing,
yeah, don't they? Yeah. Yeah. So it's essentially, at that point, you're going to say, well, hold on, Darren, I've not decided yet.
Yeah.
Then I know I need to go back and either build rapport.
Yes.
Or, you know, there's some objections I've not established.
So you're trying to avoid this sort of shock where it's like, wait a minute, you just said that too early.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah. So I think by testing the water, it's just a good way of finding out if you've covered every objection.
Sure. Okay, something a friend of mine who's also a Sandler trainer did, which I thought was really good. We were talking about him coming and doing some public speaking for us, and he was telling me about his fees and everything else. The first thing he said to me, well, first off, Rob, as we decide what I'm going to do for you, what would you want to happen so that everyone in the audience, when they're filling in the feedback forms, thought it was absolutely great?
Yeah.
So A, he's getting me to think about a happy audience.
Absolutely.
And then B, he's getting me to state an outcome. So then what he's going to do is he's going to try and match that outcome.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really clever.
Absolutely.
And then the next thing he did, he said, when we agreed it, but obviously the invoice hasn't been paid, he said, is there anything that could come up between now and paying the invoice that might be a bit of a problem for us?
That's good.
And I can't remember what I said, but I said, well, no, I think it's all right, as you know, as long as you deliver the brief, etc. Yeah. So he was getting me to state an outcome in which I would be really happy with him, and then in advance getting me to state any problems which would stop me paying him the money.
Yeah.
I just thought they were good.
It was good. We call it future pace.
Yes.
So estate agents use this a lot when they're showing people around. So I'm very curious, where would you put your TV or where would you put your settee? And they're getting them to attach their sort of personal items to that property.
Right.
It's almost like a form of anchoring.
Mm.
So yeah, by getting you to future pace, you know, how it would go. And again, in coaching, as you know yourself, having done a lot of stuff, is, you know, what's gone well, what's not gone so well, what could we do differently? So it's eliciting potential issues. So again, to minimise buyer's remorse,
yeah.
You know, that's a great technique that he did with you. You know, what could possibly come up between now and then that would stop you going ahead?
Yeah, because if I have got any final objections, there they come, and so he knows it.
Yeah.
Someone said to me, it was a friend of mine who's a speaker.
Yeah.
And in the speaking world, the thing that everyone hates is when speakers go way over time. And he'd been at an event and he said to me, Rob, just before I come and speak on your stage, I just want to tell you about what happened at this last event. You know, there was a speaker on before me and he went way over time and he upset everybody and the promoters never promoted him again. And needless to say, I'm never going to go and speak on his stage again because I was like an hour over time and I was on into the evening and then he carried on his conversation. What he was doing was making sure that when his slot and time frame is on, in my mind, he's almost programmed me to, oh, make sure we're
it's
on
a clever
time
way of just setting the frame, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's again, another clever way of doing it without kind of being quite confrontational, saying, look, I want you to do it like this.
Yeah.
You know.
So it's almost like selling an outcome through a story.
Well, it is. I mean, there's a really great book, which you may or may not be aware of. Words That Change Minds. Are you aware of that book?
No.
Right, it's a woman, Shelley Rose Charvet, she's Canadian. It's been around about 10, 15 years now. And this is literally all about, I mean, this is what I train essentially, is it's about establishing people's hot buttons to buy.
Yeah.
You know, so this internal, external is part of that book, listing for the way that people make decisions. So, you know, some people, you know, like I'm the sort of person, if I want something, I walk in, get it, walk out.
Yeah.
Whereas some people will probably need to go back two or three times, play with it, get all the information.
Is there a way you can find that out in the process?
It's essentially, just saying, so in the past, can you tell, again, asking the question, tell about a time in the past you made a really good decision and, you know, what was important to you about that? You know, what was the process that you went through? Can you tell about a past decision? Mm. So by them telling you about that, it's the same process in terms
pattern.
Of, yeah, so they're unconsciously telling you what to say next in order to, so if you know that they're the sort of person that maybe takes two or three opportunities to buy to make a decision, you're not going to change their pattern. And so what some salespeople tend to do is just keep on and on and on, and then they break rapport and it's
and
like
they lose them.
Then they lose them.
Yeah.
So sometimes it's better to recognise that people essentially don't change, Rob.
Yeah.
You know, if they make decisions, you know, to buy a settee, that will be the same. You can extrapolate that out for everything they've ever bought, because their general pattern of behaviour won't change.
Yeah.
So by just, you know, asking a few questions and eliciting what that is, you'll save yourself so much time. And in the long run, you may not get the close there and then, but you'll certainly get it two or three visits down the line.
Yeah. Okay. Biggest mistakes people make in sales. Sales teams, you go and you must have seen loads of them. Biggest mistakes.
I think generally, for me, it's just barging in. I mean, what I found is when I do sales training, you always get that the big hitter, the guy. I mean, I do a regular thing for a company, and there was one guy that was sort of sat there looking away, and you know, obviously he'll do it his way.
Yeah.
So what I found is wherever I go, and I'm sure as a public speaker you found this, there's always one person that almost wants to challenge your authority.
Yeah.
And it's ego, and I think for me, I've begun to introduce people into the process, and rather than trying to, you know, not alienate them as such, but by asking them what their secret is almost, I found that for me that's eliminated that issue. Again, I've slightly gone off piece.
That's
question.
All right, this is fine. Remember, this is what
I
happens.
I can talk for England,
yeah, absolutely. I remember someone teaching me recently, and I tried this and it really helped. Instead of asking people for help or feedback, ask for their advice. And what you find is with people like that, maybe with a bit of an ego, if you ask for their advice, it lifts them up and brings them into their position of authority.
Yeah.
Then they'll help you. Then you'll have good rapport.
Yeah, I think that's very true. I think this certain individual, the first one, he was cold and dismissive and wasn't interested. But by the second and third ones, you know, I mean, he kind of says, "Oh, have you got a book?" So I give him a book, one of my book and stuff, and I kind of get on with the guy really well now. And he says initially, I wasn't into all this stuff because I thought it was all mumbo jumbo.
Yeah.
But I think, my secret was to get him involved, like you said, have him come to the front and say, you know, I mean, he did quite a big deal recently and got him. He sees it as having a bit, he sees it like a secret recipe, so he tends to give certain things away and not others, and that's fine.
Yeah.
But I think for me, by keeping him involved and engaged, and for me, that works really well.
Yeah.
But to really come back to your question,
I think biggest mistakes.
A lot of people just, I think, go steaming in. You know, the people that can be the loudest is not always best.
No.
So I think trying to shortcut the process, a lot of people, they just want it now.
Yeah.
Like most things in life, they don't want to put the work in and get traction and momentum. You know, so I think even if you're seeing a prospect, just take your time, gauge that person. Yeah, they may be the sort of person that goes, I'll have it. And that's great, but a lot of people, you know, really are not like that. So I think don't go steaming in. That's the biggest thing that I see people do.
Are there people the opposite, where they just never really, you know, they're sort of scared of the closey bit?
Yeah, absolutely.
What tips can we give for them?
Well, again, it's about having the confidence. So, I mean, you're probably aware of visual motor rehearsal. If you're going into a particularly maybe difficult client that can never be closed, you know, just run this little movie in your head. And athletes do this. NASA used to do it with astronauts. You know, run a movie of yourself, you know, shaking hands, saying, great, thank you very much, sign the contract.
Yeah.
And what you're doing is you're programming your unconscious mind to have an idea in terms of how you want that meeting to go.
Yeah.
Now, it may differ in reality, but a lot of the time it will actually go according to plan.
Yeah.
Because the brain can't differentiate between things are real and imagined.
Sure.
So as far as your brain's concerned, you've already gone through this before.
Yeah.
So by just running that little movie in your head of how you would like it to go, similar to what the guy did with you, that's essentially what he was doing, is, you know, imagining now all your clients walking out saying, that was great, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, so it's future pacing the situation.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Is there a certain amount for these kind of people who make, like you said, they're difficult to sell to, is there a certain amount of reverse psychology? You know, for example, I'm not going to force you to do anything now. You know, you make the decision that's right for you.
Yeah, I think you can. If you've got a really strong character, you know, I mean, in the past, I've come across some really kind of really arrogant people, you know, and you think, you know, don't like you. Yeah. But I think it's, for me, and I'm guilty of it myself, it's ego. It's about stepping out and putting your ego to one side.
Yeah.
It's not a battle of wills, you know. And what's the problem with letting this guy, and to a large extent, they are above you as such because they're your client.
Yeah.
So, but I think take the ego out of the equation, you know, let them have their moment because
it
costs you nothing.
Yeah.
You know, if they want to sit there and just tell you how great they are, as long as you get a deal out the end of it, where's the big deal?
Sure. Okay. So let's move on now to the HR bit. Now, I've got a bit of a history of being disruptive.
Okay.
And I've had quite a few PAs, more than I would probably like in my record. And when I first started recruiting, it was like, let's sell the company and sell the dream.
Yeah.
And we probably got to a point where maybe we didn't intentionally oversell it, but maybe we did a bit, and then people come in and it's not quite what they want. And what we started to do recently is almost the opposite because of my reputation. And we're like, well, if you want to work with Rob, don't expect to get everything done on your to-do list.
Yeah.
Sometimes you won't hear from him for weeks, and then you'll get a massive email at 2 a.m. It's almost like we're giving all these warnings.
Sounds familiar.
Yeah. I'm glad I'm not the only one on
no,
that.
No, not at all.
And you know, we give all these warnings. And what it reminds me of is I've been listening to some podcasts, and some people in who deliver podcasts have been doing these dating tests.
Yeah.
Where instead of going, I'm great at this and I'm great at this and yeah, I'm like this and yeah, I'm like this, they're almost like they dress purposefully really badly. They don't, you know, they don't sort of, you know, shave, and they're a bit messy, and they're almost telling people all the problems about them, and oh, I'm probably not very easy to get on with, and I'm probably a bit stubborn, and I'm probably a bit selfish, blah, blah, and seeing if they're left at the end. And yeah, we've taken an almost like reverse psychology approach to HR now.
Yeah.
Because yes, we want people to take the job.
Yeah.
We want to attract the right people.
Sure.
Are we going wrong in either of these extremes? Is this qualifying people well, or does this just make people? Because sometimes I think I'm doing all this, it just makes them want it more because it ends up being reverse psychology.
It's really, honestly, this is really fascinating because I'm like that. I mean, I will literally, because my hours, I mean, 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, I'll be working on something.
Because we're manic, crazy entrepreneurs, and
that's what we do. That's what we do. We work 9 to 5.
And so we're not easy to work for.
That's absolutely. So there's kind of two people. The two patterns, we are what are called options and open. So effectively, we don't stick to a set procedure. You know, it's whatever works to make it happen. You know, whereas HR people, people that are PAs, they have they're called specific procedural people.
Right.
So they like to stick to a list.
Yes.
So if things are in the right place, it will drive them crazy.
Oh, I've had two or three like that. Yeah. They don't stay with me because it's too chaotic. And, you know, they want to tick things off their list.
Yeah. Well, that's the main reason. I mean, you know, there's someone that I used to work with that was like that. And we just agreed that it wasn't going to work because... Yeah. I'm all over the place, and that system works for me. Mm. Whereas they wanted this paperwork on time, they wanted this thing filling in, and they can't complete their report because I've not submitted this. And you know, obviously they were working for me, but they were very procedural. What they've discovered is that, for example, if you were recruiting salespeople, the way to recruit salespeople is if you were to say email in with your CV or write in with your CV if you're going back to snail mail. You probably wouldn't get the right sort of person because salespeople are, and by nature, very proactive. Let's do it now. So you'll find that for salespeople or people that are going to be in a proactive environment, you get them to call, you know, because they want to do it now. Mm-hmm. People that are more HR, more procedural, they won't call because by definition, they tend to be more reserved, less confident.
Want to plan
more. Mm. So they're the sort of people that would want to fill in an extensive application.
Yeah.
So it's all about, I think, getting that balance of, you know, what sort of person you want. And there's no finite sort of system as such, really, for getting one or the other. I mean, because they still need to be quite procedural to a degree because you want things doing. You don't want somebody off the scale options.
Yeah.
And if you say, well, where's that? Well, I ain't done it.
Yeah.
So you did, by the same definition, you don't want that sort of person. Mm. There's no definitive answer to the question, Rob, really, but it's just being aware of, is somebody very specific procedure off the scale? And you can generally sort of establish that from interview. You know, how do you go about, you know, if I was to give you this task, you know, how would you go about that? You know, if they were, well, I'd consider this and I'd research that, you know, rather than saying, well, I'd just see how it goes.
Yeah. Well, I've even heard people say, oh, I like to get things ticked off my list and they'll even do this.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you're not going to. Because the thing is, you can tick stuff off your list with me, but you're going to get stuff back on your list and your list is going to be bigger the next day.
Yeah.
So people who are very like perfectionist.
Yeah. They're just right. They drive each other crazy. Yeah. You know, if you've got two people, options and procedural, they will drive each other nuts.
Which is like me and my fiance. Which is it's still working though.
Yeah.
Okay, so if, let's say you're recruiting, do you think you should give the sales pitch, big sales pitch for the company? Do you think you should use the reverse psychology approach where you're like, these are all the downsides of us? Is it a bit of both?
Yeah, I mean, I've done quite a lot of work in this. I mean, first off, they say 20% of people applying for a job will commit a fraud to get a job. So it's not just about blagging a CV.
Yeah.
It's about blatantly, I mean, I've done lots of in London where, you know, 100K plus salaries and you've had people that have literally lied about we're even working at a job.
Right.
But to come back to your question, I think it's gonna be a mixture really of, in terms of, you know, what do they know about the company? You know, where have they worked before? Have they been in this sort of zany environment before?
Yeah.
You know, was it regimented? How did you get on? What were your feelings? Be honest about it. Mm. And that's where the deception stuff, because if they're saying, oh yeah, I'm totally used to all this, Rob, and you know, it was like that before, and generally they're not, they're just trying to pay you lip service.
Yes.
They'll again give off deceptive signals, not because they're trying to lie to you to kind of get one over.
They want a job.
They want a job.
So they'd rather white lie to get a job, because that's the thing they want, and the more they need a job.
So often people think this deceptive training is all about the negative. It's not. It's about getting, trusting your instincts and seeing changes in pattern of behaviour, because you want the right person. If they're saying, yeah, I'm used to being, you know, crazy, off the wall, proactive, then you want to see that their behaviour is consistent with what they're telling you.
Right.
So that's how it all kind of ties in almost in a way.
Yeah.
So I think it's just about having that balance.
Okay. So if you're interviewing someone, how can you get the truth out of them rather than the standard spiel, such as, you know, I love solving problems. And when you ask them about their weaknesses, well, I'm a perfectionist, but that's a good thing. You know, you hear all these sound bites, you know, like when you go to best man speeches and everybody searches the same jokes.
I know.
And you know they've just read some book. So how do you get behind that and work out what they're really like?
Well, I can think back to like many years ago, I went for a job myself, and this, when I look back now, this guy was David Brent in Kent, and he had this glass head, and he went, sell me that, kid. And he got my CV and he just went and just threw it. And he went, sell me that. And right. I tried to sell it him, and I didn't get the job. But as I look back now, I thought that was a great, refreshing way. So I think just not having, from your point of view, is not having that formalised interview. I think if you kind of set things from the outset, set the frame, that you're not running a 9-to-5 company, you know, sometimes you're going to be asked to do things over and above what you're here to do. You know, it's all about mucking in, being a team. So I think as long as they're aware of that from the outset, the signals will come out, things will come out if they're not comfortable with that sort of environment.
I find with the interviews, if you ask standard questions, you get standard answers.
Yeah.
And so probably a lot of the answers I've got is because I've asked a poor question. And I remember reading How to Hire the Next Steve Jobs by Nolan Bushnell.
Not read that book, sounds good.
Brilliant book. And he was saying, you've got to ask, number one, you can't ask the question that leads to the answer. And if you ask unconventional questions that get them to talk about what they do rather than asking them, like if you ask what your three strengths and what your three weaknesses, you're leading them to pitch you the stuff they read in a book.
Exactly, yeah.
Whereas a question he used to ask, for example, is, how many pieces of chewing gum do you think are under all the tables in this canteen? And so if someone went, well, I don't know.
Yeah.
They're not creative. They're not trying to solve a problem. Well, if someone went, oh, there are 72 tables. I guess maybe one person per table is chewing gum. I guess one in five might stick it underneath. It looks like the tables are changed 20 times. Let me just work this out.
Yeah.
Whilst I don't know for sure, maybe if I times 1 by 10 by 25 tables, I get, maybe 17 a day.
I think using abstract things like that are far more better, because I think the kind of like tried and tested, very stoic interview process, you know, for people like us, that life's not like that. You know, if you look at in terms of my journey to where I am at the moment, you know, it's not a bad thing if you've had a lot of jobs. It just means that, you know, you've not fitted in.
Yeah.
You know, as an entrepreneur, you know, I don't think I ever lasted in a job more than a year, you know, because I'm just not made that way. I have to call the shots myself. I have to make the decisions.
Sure.
So I think using different methods, anything that's different, anything that works, like you've just suggested, because in asking them that, you know, you're getting a handle in terms of how they think, how they operate, can they think outside the box?
Yeah.
And again, by framing it, you know, I had this situation before, you know, how would you have dealt with that?
Yeah.
So I just think it's important, especially what we do, you know, because it's not just the normal 9-to-5, is using those sort of techniques.
Mm.
And I think more and more companies are coming onto that.
Yeah. Another example here is when we're hiring for events, where you need to work weekends because we do loads of weekends. I mean, we do 500 events a year.
Yeah.
So that's like, what, 1.5 a day or something. Mm. And if we said to them, hey, are you prepared to work weekends? Oh, yeah. But of course they never, you know, so someone comes, they work one weekend in four and they don't want to leave. Whereas if we say, what do you do on your weekends?
Yeah.
Work or not work. Absolutely. Is what they often come back. Well, whatever. What do you normally like to do? Tell us the last 6 weekends. What did you do?
Yeah.
Cinema, friends, friends, dog sitting, cinema, friends. They're not going to do weekend work for events.
No.
So I guess what we've learned or tried to learn over the years is try not to ask the direct question, but try and go around the side and the back.
Definitely.
To get them to talk about not what they would say they do, but actually what they do.
Yeah. And I mean, it's almost like a hypnotic technique, because they say that you won't affect people directly, but you'll affect them indirectly. Likewise, you know, some people will be very guarded. They'll be wanting to give you the answer that they think you want to hear.
Mm.
You know, so by doing that, there's no pressure on them because they're not aware of the fact that what the true intent of the question is.
Yeah. I love a challenge. I love being busy.
I'm proactive. I'm a self-starter. Yeah. All these cliches.
Yeah. I stay late. I work hard. I never miss a deadline.
I'll never phone it. I think doing what we do, I just love it, because it's just completely out of the box.
Mm.
And I think that's why I try and promote when I do, you know, work with companies, is that more and more companies are realising that, you know, the old ways, they don't really work, you know, and the cost of a bad hire is very expensive. If you've got someone that's
we're hiring for an FD, 6-figure salary, 20% recruitment fee.
Yeah.
20%.
Yeah.
You know, not on the lower end salaries, it might be 10%, 12.5%.
Definitely.
20%.
So it's really important to make sure that, you know, get it right.
Yeah. Okay, so any major lies you've seen or heard in interviews? common lies?
I think the main ones are the reasons people leave. I mean, salespeople never get sacked, they just leave, don't they?
Yeah.
More or less required to resign. So I think reasons for leaving the job is the biggest.
That's the first question I always ask, because you want to see the pattern.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And generally, you know, in terms of the length of service that they spent at a job, because I think in most people's minds, they try to create this linear CV. Well, life's not like that. Yeah. You know, if I was to give you my true CV, there's more holes in it than Swiss cheese.
Yeah.
You know, because I've been around to, you know, that didn't work, so I had time out, I've done this. So it would be like this, my sort of progression.
Yeah.
So I think whenever I see, or whenever I work with HR people and I see a linear CV that's start, finish, I think that's a red flag. Because I don't think most people's lives... It's too perfect. Most people's lives aren't like that.
Yeah.
So that becomes a red flag.
Yeah. Should we be making people feel comfortable in a interview so that we can get the real them, or should we be trying to just shock them and test them a little bit?
I think at the end of the day, you want to see the real person. So my personal view is, you know, is just, kind of make them, just let them know what's going to be expected of them. It is going to be fast-paced, proactive, blah, blah, blah. Mm. And if you're not that sort of person, it's, you know, don't tell me what I want to hear.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to be under pressure to perform and do X, Y, and Z. So I think by trying to get and elicit the real person, I think for me that's the most important thing.
For example, if they're nervous, seeing that and trying to calm them down a bit, because I've interviewed a lot of people who, at first interview, my MD or head of HR said this person was really good, and they're sitting there, and 15 minutes in, they're looking at me, and at the end they say, that was not the person I saw, they were really nervous. Because obviously, you know, I'm the owner of the company, I'm interviewing them sometimes. Yeah. So sometimes you don't see the real person. So in the past, being the entrepreneur, maybe a bit cocky when I was in my 20s, I always used to want to sort of shock people a bit. I've never ripped a CV and I've never said, sell me this thing. But I'll probably be a bit more like that, trying to sort of, you know, be distracted on purpose, you know, shock them emotionally a bit to see who's really behind them. But a lot, if someone's nervous, you're going to break them.
Yeah, I think it's contextual. I mean, sometimes it might be appropriate to put them a bit under pressure.
Yeah.
Because if they're sort of stressed with you,
or they're good at being interviewed and they're too polished.
Yeah, they're too polished. So if they're going to be going out pitching and doing X, Y, and Z, you know, generally they're going to be pitching the CEO of the company. Mm. So if they're intimidated by you and they're going to be working for you, then they're going to be like that in other situations. Mm. So, you know, behaviour will be consistent. So it's important to know that the person's not going to go to pieces when they're going out pitching.
Sure.
So I think, maybe a little bit of pressure is a good thing.
Yeah. Okay. You said a really interesting stat earlier, and it was something like the average person lies up to 200 times a day.
Yeah.
That is a shocker. Wow. So have you got any other surprising stats like that about lying or telling the truth?
Yeah. The average sort of 10 minutes of conversation. So I don't know how many we've told here, but in the average 10 minutes of conversation, the average person will lie 3 times. And that can be generally like innocuous. You might say, oh, Darren, are you okay?
Yeah.
And I might have a migraine right now, but I'll say, oh, I'm great, thanks, Rob.
Yeah.
So, you know, things as small as that, right up to big lies. Yeah. So that's where they get the stat, 200 times. But yeah, generally 200 times, 20% of the job applicants commit a fraud. And 10 minutes of conversation, you'll lie 3 times.
Yeah.
That's the sort of main stats that we say.
Any common lies you saw when you're in the police?
I think generally, you know, things like seatbelts, you know, they were bread and butter of policing. Seatbelts, lights out, being on a mobile phone, you know, like I was behind a guy once on his phone. And I'm just sat there. I thought, I'll give him benefit of the doubt to put it down before we get to this island. And he's still on it.
Right.
And I stop him. And he's like, I wasn't on my phone. If he'd have said, look, I'm so sorry, I shouldn't have done it. And I said, okay, you know, get yourself an hands-free, get yourself off. Because I was that sort of police officer. I wasn't, you know, like this crazy ticket writing guy. But this particular guy just fronted it. You know, and he was like, I says, right, I'm just going to show you something. So I pressed the camera and, you know, he's like...
Right.
So sometimes just the tenacity of people to insult your intelligence, really.
Yeah. It's funny you reminded me of something completely random that I've never told anyone when I was 17. But I drove my sister to Cambridge from where I lived, and I had like an Astra. So it was like, you know, the police are obviously going to pull me over. And I was driving along and I wasn't speeding. I was with my sister.
Yeah.
And I didn't have my seatbelt on. I really panicked. I was like, and I pulled over and I pretended to take it off.
Yeah.
And when I opened the window, he went in and he said, you had your seatbelt on, but she didn't. And I got away with it because I pretended to take my seatbelt off.
I've done that before.
Random.
Yeah. So sometimes it pays off.
Yeah, okay. I'm trying to think now, if if there's three lies every 10 minutes, we've been speaking for an hour.
Yeah.
30 lies.
Yeah, statistically, really? That's what they say.
Wow.
I'm trying to think what I've told you, which is a lie. I don't know. Yeah. Can't think of any, but we'll play it back and see my tells.
This podcast is called The Disruptive Entrepreneur. What does the word disruptive mean to you?
I think for me, it's a great thing because I think if people that know me really well, they'll know that I am just off the wall with it.
Yeah.
You know, I think when people first meet me, they think I'm going to be this kind of really serious.
Yeah.
But no, I think it's so important to keep changing, keep evolving.
Right.
You know, don't stay with, you know, if something works, great. But every now and then, I think a bit of disruption is a good thing
yeah.
for me.
Okay. Great. And do you ever have a problem, just as just sort of like yeah. a random question now, but do you ever have a problem with people because you're so well known for being the human lie detector? Does that affect how people are with you sometimes? It's like your reputation precedes you almost.
I think so. I think it's going to get worse. I've just shot the next series of Judge Rinder, Crime right. Stories. I'm on that in June.
Yeah.
So obviously, I'm going to raise my profile somewhat. But generally, when I do meet people, certainly in the media, you know, they make a joke and say, oh, you know, I'm sort of a bit scared of how I'm going to come over.
Yeah.
And I just reassure them and say, it's too late. I've already made my opinion of you.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
And start laughing.
So you have a bit of fun with it.
Bit of fun with it because it's... You know, I love what I do. I'm passionate about what I do. I don't walk around and sort of scrutinise everybody. Mm. You know, I'm just a down-to-earth guy. I love what he does.
Yeah.
And like I say, I don't just sit there eyeballing everybody.
No, sure.
Without retiring.
Yeah. Another random question. If you're someone who's got great skills in watching people's tells...
Sure.
Does that sometimes make you feel like you know too much? You know, for example, as a kid, you always imagine, wouldn't it be great to know what everyone's thinking about you? But you know as an adult, that'd be terrible because you'd just drive yourself mad knowing what they're thinking about you all the time.
Yeah.
You know, being Darren, knowing and seeing people's signs, does that somehow take away the mystique and the beauty and the surprise of life? Or can you turn it off?
Do you know what? That is a really good question. I've never ever been asked that in all the
years. We've got one in that you've never been asked.
I think sometimes thinking about it, yeah, it is, because sometimes you'll meet somebody and they seem really nice and then I'll see something and I sort of kind of think, oh, that's a shame.
Yeah.
You know.
Because maybe you don't want to know that.
I don't want to know
like
that.
A bit like the example where you had the friend and the person who was cheating on you. You just don't want to know that information with your friends,
No. So I think, again, you know, I'm not Darren Brown, I'm not a mind reader. Sometimes I can be wrong. But generally, once you know these skills, you can't turn them off.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm vegetarian and I went somewhere... Went somewhere recently and about the tongs, because I'm a bit OCD when they use meat in there. And I said, you've not touched the meat ones on the hash browns, have you?
Yeah.
And they were like, oh no, not at all. Yeah. You know, and they did this gesture because there's a thing on the back of the neck, which is why when people go like that, when they get stressed, when they lie,
right.
there's erectile tissue on the end of the nose, almost like Pinocchio.
Right.
That they'll tend to go like that, anti-mouth gesture. That tingles, and also when people, you know, are under pressure straight away, they'll tend to go like that. But she made a couple of gestures, and I was like, "No, I'm all right, thanks."
Yeah.
And just be honest with me, you know.
Yeah.
I said, "Be honest with me, you know, you've not got cross contaminated those tongs, have you?"
Yeah.
And she's like, "No, not at all." You know, you have washed your hands when you went to the toilet, didn't you? Not at all.
Yeah.
So it's got its uses, but yeah, sometimes, you know, it is a bit of a curse, really. Mm.
Yeah. Just a bit of a throwaway.
It's a good question though.
Is there anything I should have asked you that I haven't? In a minute, I'd like you to tell us if you've got any books or what you're doing. But thank you, by the way, for coming all this way. And
I really appreciate the opportunity. Thank you very much, Rob.
Great. So is there anything I should have asked you?
You honestly, you should be on question time because I've never been asked that. That is a really good question. I think just in terms of like where I want to go with it, really.
Go on, to answer that question that I didn't ask.
Yeah, I think you know the lie detection stuff's going to have a shelf life. I mean, at the moment, you know, touch wood, I'm doing well, and I've got quite a few sort of products and stuff happening on TV because that's where I want to take it now. And I've done quite a lot of contribution stuff like the one show and various other bits and bobs, and so I've got this Judge Rinder show coming out. So just really, you know, where I would like to take it. So ultimately, my goal is to have my own show, not specifically with deception, but around, because I love social psychology.
Yeah.
I love why people conform or don't conform, why people do certain things. You know, there's lots of experiments in psychology, you know, that have explored that.
Yeah.
You know, if something's kicking off over there, what's the difference that would make you and me intervene in that situation? And some people turn away.
Yeah.
So I'd love to have some sort of show that explores that in a fresh setting.
Yeah, that would be interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. So where can people find out more about you, Darren?
Our website is obviously darrenstanton.co.uk. Twitter at Darren Stanton. I'm on LinkedIn.
I think that's how we got in touch.
That's how we got in touch. Yeah. So generally through Twitter or
And I noticed you retweeted some of my stuff, so thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
And I'm not trying to program you to retweet this when it comes out. But
So before we begin to tweet even more, Darren. So, and that's another thing. It's about creating relations. It's about helping each other. Because no matter how big somebody is, you know, it's about genuinely, it's about creating that relationship, you know, I think. And if you can help and support other people, like, you know, I need help and support, you know. I don't think I know it all, and I've not arrived at my final destination by any means. So any help or support I can get or feedback, I'm happy to take it.
Darren, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for coming to see me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Cheers. Thank you.